Welcome, everyone. Thanks for joining us. This is Denny with Karl Mollison with GetWisdom, and we're going to continue with the channeling series that we've been doing for some time now. And today, Karl is going to channel Art Bell, who he passed in April of 2018, and he was in need of a spirit rescue. And I had the pleasure of doing the spirit rescue for him at that time, or shortly after his passing. At the time I did that, we also did one for Jim Mars, but I think Jim Mars didn't need one, if I remember correctly. But in any case, that's who we're going to channel today. And I came up with 9 questions, and I learned quite a bit researching him. I used to listen to him, but I wasn't. He had some very dedicated followers, many people who would never miss one of his shows. So, so I'm sensitive to the fact that there's going to be a lot of people out there who know a lot more about Art Bell than I do. And so, my apologies before, in advance, if my questions aren't quite up to snuff, but I think we're going to do okay with this. And so thank you, Karl. Thank you for joining us today, and thank you for doing this.
Well, right back at you. We are in this together and working in earnest to help explore and learn and bring forward the truth of things. And it's no easy task when the majority of the world is either asleep or being subjugated and suppressed and monitored and manipulated in very sinister ways to misdirect people's thinking and even to keep them complacent through a direct interference with their thoughts. Mm-hmm. This is what it's come to. And people are shocked, and they think, this is the worst yet, the crazy notions and the tinfoil hat, mantras, and it sounds preposterous. It sounds paranoidal and delusional. And I fully grant that, because I would think the same if someone told me out of the blue without giving me lots and lots of evidence. But that is part of what we're about. Filling in the blanks to show that some of the crazy things that happen only make sense or make the most sense if there is a broader agenda going on.
Right.
To subvert thinking, shift people into a different kind of mode and change them. And you see that all over now with all the political movements and how people are really acting crazy. They're suspending reason and judgment, logic. And they do it for their cause, whether it's right or left in orientation. It doesn't matter. Is it sensible? Is it realistic? Is it proportional to how we typically run things, which is based on law and debate and using logic and common sense? So when that gets sort of thrown out, and people are acting contrary to who they used to be, that's a big, big warning sign that there's something odd happening.
Right.
So the people who can stand above that manipulation often stand around and scratch their heads and wonder, where did the world go? How did we get here? This is really odd. And they might not find it all of it alarming or strange. They might be sympathetic to some of the people who are acting a bit strangely. But that doesn't help the situation to be complacent also. So this is a tough challenge, So I don't know a lot about Art Bell. I was aware of him and his program. For the most part, I was not a listener because in my area of the country in the Midwest, he was on too late for me in the day.
Right.
If he had been a daytime person, I probably would have listened to him religiously, unless I got turned off by a particular program, because he often was probing into things I was curious about.
You're right.
As a seeker. And it turns out there's a good reason to be interested in the paranormal and in UFOs, which were a large part of his appetite and his curiosity in seeking out people to talk. And that good reason is those two contingents of people who are interested are escaping the mind control manipulation. And if you're not subjugated with a manipulation, you got to wonder about the bizarre paranormal things people can do. And you also have to wonder, what's with this extraterrestrial thing that never goes away? That we've got physical evidence, we've got motion pictures and videos.
Testimonials.
Hundreds of thousands of sightings by normal people.
Right.
By law enforcement officers, by military participants and pilots, and simultaneous observations from the air, from other aircraft, ground control radar, people on the ground, seeing all of it sort of play out. I mean, over and over and over again, and all the abductions that people talk about when they are traumatized and so on. So there's a huge effort to suppress that because it is telling us something really important. Both those things. Because we are intuitive, we have an intuitive reach, and that is the gateway to the divine, which we need to be connecting to get help here. And all the things being done behind the scenes in collusion with our military are sinister. And they have encroached on our world and are running things from behind the scenes. So that's kind of the bottom line I come from because of all the things that I know and that I have uncovered with my own research, and it fully explains all the other stuff that people have observed here and there, and in aggregate is an overwhelming conundrum. Mm-hmm. So the biggest impression I have of Art Bell in my memory bank is being on Hawaii, one of the Hawaiian islands, on vacation. And because it's so many hours
right,
you know, east of the continental U.S.
Right,
you know, I was still up. You know, it was in the evening, and I was driving somewhere like back to my motel, and I was flipping around on the radio, and I heard Art Bell's show, and he was interviewing Philip Corso, who was a colonel in the Army, and during the 40s and 50s, and wrote a book shortly before he passed about those days and what happened in Roswell with the downed UFOs and the
right.
recovery of aliens and so on. And
right.
so he was talking about what he was doing and so on. And I was fascinated because I'd always been interested in that topic. But this is the kind of thing I know he had on his show.
Yeah.
Groundbreaking things.
Right.
Very controversial.
Yeah.
But far out, and that's the earmark of someone who is not being subjugated, who is able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of amazing that he got away with it.
Yeah,
as long as he did, because he was really poking into a lot of dark corners.
Yeah, and a lot of people during those years who were doing similar things didn't fare so well.
Yes.
And they have been the subject of this series, namely Dr. Carla Turner, Barbara Bertolic, Phil Schneider, Bill Cooper, and there's probably quite a few others that we don't know about that should be on this series, but we just don't know about them because they didn't get as far as those people to become that well known. But yeah, they were disclosing things that... that were evidently pretty sensitive, you know, and he was right there in the middle of all that.
And taking on
people with testimonies that were even more incredible than what some of these people were saying, the people I just mentioned, you know. I mean, mm-hmm. all of it's, you know, heavy fare, so to speak. But he did that for years. You know, for years and years. But he was there, you know, we're going to get into this a little bit with the questions. There was some some things that happened that made you think, well, maybe, you know, there was some pressure on him to stop doing what he was doing. You know, I don't know that it's definitive, and I don't know that the answers we're going to get today are going to make it any more clear, because we do have the issue of safety and karmic entanglement, which are two things that are in a large consideration when we're communicating with the divine realm. They're not going to tell us something that's going to jeopardize our safety, and they're not going to make a karmic situation worse by telling us, you know, giving us additional information that's not known. So, I mean, that's another thing that we kind of have to dance around with these questions, you know. And with Art Bell, unfortunately, a lot of the obvious questions, the things that people want to know about, kind of point in that direction. So that's just part of the game, well, you know.
Yeah, and we're taking on the risks of doing this in the first place, and looking into a figure who may well have been targeted,
right,
by the cabal for being too open, too indiscreet, and not able to be suppressed.
Right.
And those who can withstand the attempts to manipulate often receive more direct attention, you know, the Men in Black kind of scenario, where people show up and then seek to intimidate the subject.
Right.
And give veiled threats. So they hopefully will put two and two together and realize, well, I better shut up now. And often that's all that's needed.
Yeah.
But it can escalate from there, and people can be taken out.
Yeah.
Especially if there's urgency about some pending revelation or something, and they see it coming. But I don't want to presume anything here, but he's a person that I marveled at because of his forthrightness.
Yeah.
And I didn't appreciate it at the time, but as I really started to look more deeply at what's happening and become a channeler to enable me to talk with the light and get some definitive, you know, kind of higher perspective views and confirmation of the big picture and what's really happening here. You know, looking back, it's rather amazing when people like that can get as far as they have.
Yeah.
And it does give me hope, because they're not so powerful and so thorough and so scrupulous that they can be right there at the first infraction and eliminate you. You know, mm-hmm. they have to work through human means, primarily because of the level of need for secrecy, mm-hmm. and to not create too obvious a heavy footprint.
Yeah.
You know, if suddenly all the critics disappear, people are going to notice.
Right.
And they can't do that.
Right.
So they have to kind of pick and choose and, you know, go a little bit slow. You know, so it's just like with the natural disasters.
Right.
They could probably put a hurricane on all coasts of the United States simultaneously and keep that going indefinitely if they wanted to. But they don't. They have to make it look more natural, more like random. And
yeah.
Sometimes it makes landfall, sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
And then, it, you know, we just think it's nature.
Right.
So,
yeah. Okay. Well,
but he was kind of a natural force, that guy.
Yeah.
I was very impressed with him.
Yeah. He was really good at, like, just kind of keeping a balanced, grounded environment for all the craziness. You know, the really interesting, high profile subjects, and the ones that were just the opposite of that. And, you know, the boring ones and the ones that just were defied belief, you know. Like, I always think of the one with the man who claimed to be an Area 51 employee, and he was saying that they were after him, and he was really upset and frantic. Did you ever hear that one? He called in on the show. It was a viewer call-in kind of thing, and Art, you know, just kept him on the line, and the guy told his story. It was, you know, high drama, and I wonder, like, if a guy had called a different radio host, how that would have went, you know? And
Well, there you go. I mean, this you can see this in the lack of interest by the media as a whole in all these topics. They just completely dismiss it.
Write him off as crazy. Next caller.
That's right. They just hang up and because they think they're talking to someone who's deranged. And this is a mind control programming. They cannot hold the thought that maybe there could be truth and something worth listening to because they're programmed to disregard it and dismiss it immediately and drop it like a hot potato because it could be dangerous even and entangle them in something that'll blow up in their face. And so who would want to do that? You know, it just would be crazy and irresponsible to give time to such a story, you know. And so they think they're doing their job and doing it well and safeguarding truth and all of it. And that's the nature of the world we're in. So when you're talking from having your head above the clouds, you're pretty much alone. And there are a few people open to hearing the message. And that's always the hope that you'll reach them. And it's unfortunate we can't get on a platform like that at the present time, at least, because it's too controlled. And there is a semblance of freedom. And this is the thing that's the most ingenious about what they do. They don't censor debate entirely. They encourage debate about things that are safe, about human level concerns. And often they're fairly trivial, but they're blown up into like a national dilemma, you know, like a single political appointment, you know, which I'm not trying to demean or dismiss is unimportant. But do you have the entirety of the world still turning and so many unmet needs and so on? And what that occupies all the oxygen, all the brain power, all the attention of human capital, just focusing on that alone, which doesn't need all the attention. It's going to happen one way or the other anyway, because the people responsible carry out the events and so on. But this is, you know, they put on this huge show. It's all orchestrated to keep people complacent, but to create the illusion of free will, that we have freedom to choose what we do. Because look, you know, all kinds of people are launching their opinions and they're even getting violent at times. And we don't have an iron fist, you know, constraining anyone. You know, it's a free for all out there. Look, you know, and it looks that way. And meanwhile, much of that seeming freedom is orchestrated to happen, to gin things up and get people riled up.
The theater is the prison.
It's amazing. And how clever is it? Oh,
And it works every time.
yeah, we're suckers for it.
Even
It's
when there
entertainment.
wasn't any TV, they were doing the same exact thing back in Rome.
Well,
And it worked like a charm.
yeah.
So nothing new under the sun, they say.
And unfortunately.
Okay, so let's see what art has to say.
All right, we'll go for it. So I will take a moment to get in the stage of the state of consciousness that I need to make the connection to Art Bell in the light. And I will be putting protection around the work to ensure that I connect to him and him alone through Creator. That's how I do it. And I'm very adamant about safeguards for any channeling work, any intuitive work, even just doing meditation, because there are lower level beings watching the sky, so to speak. They're aware of anyone reaching out intuitively because those people, again, are a risk for them potentially. And it's also an opportunity for them to do a handshake in a very deep level of the mind. And they love doing that because then they can get in and manipulate the person further. And it can drag the person down, keep them constrained more and more. And once they kind of check that person out and see what they're potentially able to do or interested in doing, they can go to work and shift it around and misdirect and deflect things and so on. So you're taking risks when you do it. And it's surprising to people because you're reaching out. Often people are reaching out to higher realms. They want to talk to a benevolent extraterrestrial or a spirit guide or their higher self or maybe an angelic figure. And so they can't imagine that someone like an archangel would ever allow, or, you know, let alone God, ever allow someone to elbow in front and start speaking for that figure. But mm-hmm. it happens all the time.
Yeah.
Because of free will. So we have the burden and responsibility to keep things accurate and safe. So I do the best I can. That's all I can promise. So I just want to put that four square in front because people need to think when they go out and about and look at what other people are doing. So they have it in their mind, you know, to wonder whether they are using safeguards. Mm-hmm. And then whether their information is really reliable.
Right.
Because the messages that come through are very crafty.
Right.
It's almost always something positive. Yeah. And something about love and how things are going to continue to improve. And there'll be some promised event that is magnificent. And it all sounds wonderful. They don't come through in a heavy-handed way. That would be too obvious. You know, hey, what am I talking to here? This doesn't sound like a divine realm representative, you know. But they can put on a show because right. they know us inside out.
Right.
They've been dealing with us in our religious
beliefs for millennia. It's their playground.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. And they're smarter than we are. So, in our physical form.
Mm-hmm.
All right, enough okay. of that. So, okay.
Thanks.
This is Art Bell speaking.
Thank you for joining us. Was yours what could be called a natural death? Was the coroner's report correct concerning the drugs found in your system? And was there any foul play?
Unfortunately, there was foul play involved. And I do not wish to give much detail here because there is a potential for complications for those in the living, those who did the investigative work, the legal consequences of my passing. And those who remain connected to me. And I do not wish any kind of retribution or any further complications or entanglements for those lovely people. My life was a difficult one in many ways and created many difficult moments. And more than I expected, in fact. So I understand, especially now, from my new perch, looking down on all that happened and all that still is ongoing, the vastness, complexity, multi-layers, and the sheer enormity of all of the workings of the power structure and its control and grip on the planet. It is amazing there are individuals still slipping through the cracks and able to raise their voice, let alone sound an alarm. So suffice it to say, I died as a result of foul play. And it was a retribution and a proactive form of management to keep me silenced. This was a final closure on my potential as an incorrigible human seen from the perspective of the extraterrestrial alliance, who were the true cause of my early death. I was being unruly from their perspective and failing to be numbed and dumbed down through mind control. I had been threatened a number of times and knew the handwriting on the wall, but thought I could be safe. And as it turned out, that was all along an illusion. There can be no true safety when the alliance puts its mind to silencing someone. This is just the way things are. It is a fact of the matter. So those who speak forth do so bravely, whether in full awareness or not. But this is sorely needed. And most of all, I do not wish my passing to dampen the enthusiasm and the commitment and ardor of those remaining as light workers to stand down from their mission in any way. They are needed more urgently than ever before in human history. Things are rushing towards a grand climax here, and now is not the time to be faint of heart. There is no escaping the future. It comes to all, regardless of where you might be. Even if you're safe on a remote tropical island of no interest to anyone else and living a life that is self-sustaining and a life of ease, sooner or later, the future will catch up to you as well. Whether you remain here successfully in the living as physical human or return to the light, the future will still impact you and will be a heavy impact. This is always the case. You are never done as a human in the collective of humanity. You have an obligation as a human citizen and member of this sacred circle to contribute what you can to human betterment. And in honor of your commitment to come here in the first place and make the decision to work for the truth of the divine.
Okay, this question might be a little bit obvious, but I'm going to ask it anyway in case you want to flesh it out some more. Were you subject to the attack in your life? Were you subject to attack in your life and after you passed due to the information you brought forth in your radio show, Coast to Coast?
This is very much the case. I was attacked again and again and again and again in many ways, subtle and overt. There were many, many attempts to co-opt my mind and my thinking, to redirect and suppress my curiosity, to give me disincentives to exercise my curious nature and explore those areas of interest to me. And when that did not work, my operation was infiltrated by a series of storytellers who were mind-controlled to come forth with essentially a tall tale, which sounded intriguing. And because of its highly unusual nature, would seem to be a compelling subject for a radio interview. And after all, to stay in business and be on the air, the obligation falls heavily on the producer and host of the program to keep the interest high and to keep the listeners listening in order to attract advertising revenue to pay the expenses. So this cannot be ignored. It is a basic necessity and responsibility. Not having perfect discernment, I could not know who among these people coming forward were telling the truth and who were not. And the more I probed into the unusual, the more I learned that common sense was a very poor yardstick to assess personal experiences of others, particularly in the arenas of high strangeness I was drawn to, in which I now see and re-echo the sentiment expressed by your channeler earlier, that those areas of high strangeness are exceedingly important. They are not esoteric fringe elements of the culture or irrelevant to the main issues before society. They are central to the workings of the universe and to the future of humanity to sort out friend from foe. Because what is strange in your world often does not belong and poses a dire threat to human survival. To ignore that as a host of a program dedicated to bring forth new information would be a travesty and a moral lapse as well. The disinformation campaigns were ongoing, never ending. And this was not done to me alone. It is done to everyone engaged in any kind of forum where the unusual might be discussed. The purpose, of course, is sinister. It is to plant seeds of destruction for the theorists who are fascinated with the workings of the mind and of consciousness on the one hand, including the workings of spirituality and their manifestation, and then on the other, the extraterrestrial question, evidence of their presence, the implications about what the true alien agenda might be. So the way that the disinformation works is to have enough of these landmines appear and then go on record, knowing that the story on deep inspection and research will end up being discredited eventually, and thereby will discredit the host who gives it credence, at least superficially, by allowing them to appear on the platform for broadcast. This happens again and again through all of life in many sectors. It is a common tactic of the extraterrestrial alliance to allow or encourage someone to gain prominence within an organization, whether it is public or private. And this then is followed sometime, even years later, by a revelation of former undoing that may have been orchestrated to happen, to plant the seeds of destruction. And their coming into prominence may have been wholly orchestrated as well. It is kind of a game that is played to put in faulty leaders and then show them to have feet of clay and then laugh as the damage ensues and the embarrassment and the humiliation, both of those individuals themselves who were blind to their weakness and were unable to keep it in perspective, and to their supporters who vouched for them, worked with them, became trusted colleagues and acolytes, and then are tarnished with the same brush oftentimes. This was the purpose of the disinformation sent my way. And it was not only to tie me to a series of crazy people and their crazy ideas, but to, more importantly, confuse and confound the general public, who, not being in a position to vet those who came forward and do research personally to verify their claims in any way, would still see all of it as very bizarre, highly unusual and strange in the telling. And when things began to be discredited in what seems a basic, fundamental fashion, then can easily dismiss the whole, that it is the source that's the problem. It is that crazy Art Bell bringing another nut in front of the public just to exploit them or willingly participate in a scam in order to make money and have a following. And this, of course, appears to be completely scurrilous and reprehensible. The opposite was the case. I have nothing to hide here and will own up to my faults, but they are beside the point. I was actually working in earnest to do the best I could to find truth. I was not a perfect barometer to tell truth from fiction. Very few people can do this with accuracy, because the only way one can is to be a true insider or to have a highly refined intuitive connection to their guidance and actively seek an answer for them to weigh in. Because otherwise, people are on their own and allowed to make their own judgments and own decisions and work only from their knowledge base and their prejudices. The attacks continue and worsen. And of course, my passing is the capper in showing what can happen when the plans to discredit fall through.
Was Ramona also targeted?